We are really fortunate to have Ashish Kothari as the keynote speaker. Ashish is a leading thinker, writer, speaker, teacher, and activist from India and internationally. Ashish is from Kalpavriksh, that is an environmental action group. He's one of the founding members of that group, and he is a sociologist by training. Ashish has written extensively on forests, conservation, environmental issues, and development alternatives. Last year, he edited a book called Alternative Futures, India Unshackled. And now, he is going to give us his speech about radical ecological democracy towards transformative alternatives to development. Please give Ashish Kothari a warm welcome.
Thank you, Hanne, and thanks to the Political Ecology Network. I should say that apart from the usual nervousness of speaking to a few hundred people, I'm also nervous because I'm a bit like a fish out of water here. I left academics when I finished my master's. And though because I've written a few books, people call me Dr. Ashish Kothari, I'm not PhD at all. So some of what I'm going to say here might not seem particularly academically rigorous to you. And a lot of it is emerging from experience working with or being involved with movements and communities, especially in India. So excuse me if there isn't too much citation and footnotes and the usual academic stuff, all of which is great and necessary, of course. I'm not in any way making fun of it, but that's... Please don't expect that. I see that with a lot of comfort that we do have Indian standard time working here also. So we're about 15 minutes over time. So I hope we can cut a little bit into the coffee afterwards so that there's enough time for questions and interaction. Right, so let me start off. today's session is going to be in the following order. A very, very short unappetizer, which is about the problems with the current model of development. Very short, all of you are familiar with the kind of problems that we face, so I don't need to go into that in detail. Secondly, then looking at some practical on-the-ground alternatives from, especially from India, but also mentioning a few from outside India. Third, then looking at what's emerging from those alternative transformations on the ground in terms of a larger framework or worldview or frameworks of alternatives to development. And I will keep saying alternatives to development and not alternative development or sustainable development, and we can discuss that later. I'll then go into very briefly some of the key points that need elaboration, that need clarification, that need a diversity of perspectives and thoughts, and hopefully we'll have some time to get into that in the discussion. And then I'm going to end with talking about a process that we've started in India and which hopefully can also become more global. So starting with the unappetizer, and it's a good thing that this is not just before lunch, because you would lose your appetite for lunch if this was. Basically, this is very familiar to you, but if you look at these two advertisements from India, they kind of in one way or the other depict what has become a horrible reality in many parts of the world, which is that the way in which neoliberal development has been imposed across the world, a particular notion of what is development, is very much a form of violence. It's a violence against nature, as you see in the left-hand advertisement. It's a violence against communities in many parts of India and, of course, in many other parts of the world, as very ably demonstrated by EJ Atlas, of which there are a number of representatives here. the Environmental Justice Atlas. Development is done at the barrel of the gun. People are killed, people are imprisoned, people are physically, forcibly thrown out of their lands, and so on. Economic growth, if you go to a doctor and the doctor says, oh, you've got some growth, you're going to panic, right? Because it's cancer. But when an economist comes and says, oh, there's growth, well, it's like celebration. So, you know, we need to start questioning this model of development altogether in a very fundamental way. It's not just violence against communities and nature and so on. It's also violence against us individually, against our philosophical, spiritual selves, because we are so caught up in the project of modernity and development that we are not actually even looking inside ourselves anymore. Yeah? And so I call that a process of moving from what used to be, and still in some parts of the world, are livelihoods. Livelihoods are not jobs. They are ways of being. They are occupations, work, labor, along with culture, nature, and so on and so forth. We moved from that into what I call deadlihoods, where we have boring 9-to-5 jobs. We wait for the weekend. We wait for 5 o'clock and say, oh, now the holidays begin. It's because we're not enjoying our work anymore. That's true for most of us. It's not necessarily true for everybody. And so this really, in the last few decades or maybe a few centuries, we moved into this process of destroying livelihoods and creating deadlihoods, even those of us who might be making lots of money. This is also a process which has created enormous inequalities. I think you're all familiar with the work of various people who've shown the way in which inequalities have risen all across the world. With now, I think in fact even this figure has changed now. Instead of 42 billionaires, it's an even smaller number of billionaires who control or own for 50% of the world's wealth. In India, it's now 65 to 70% of India's wealth is owned by the top 1% of the population. And that figure is just steadily rising. And so therefore we get this incredible phenomenon of some of the world's poorest people living just below the world's largest house. This is a 27-story house in Bombay belonging to one family, India's richest family. And finally, this is a process in which all of us, as activists, as citizens, as activist scholars, as political ecologists, are faced in, at least in many countries, with the prospect of shrinking democracy. We've seen in India, for instance, laws that were fought for the environment, for labor rights, and so on, are steadily being whittled down, diluted, or removed. There are attacks on civil society, on groups that actually dissent from the government. Just last week, several people have been arrested in India for dissenting from an expressway that was going to go through and cut through communities and forests. Before that, or 2 months back, 17 people were killed protesting against a pollution from a local factory, and so on. So this is the kind of we're seeing not just the attack on nature and communities, but also on the very notions of democratic civic dissent in many parts of the world. So the question that arises is, do we have alternatives? Or are we faced with the prospect of Margaret Thatcher's famous dictum, there is no alternative, the TINA factor, as it was called? When we ask that question, it's very important to ask ourselves, alternatives to what? Are we saying, okay, there's a lot of plastic pollution, so let's recycle it? Is that the alternative? Or are we actually fundamentally questioning the production of plastic, the plasticization of our life in the first place? And so I think it's very important to actually look at the structural roots of the systemic roots of the kinds of problems that we're talking about. And I'm being very simplistic here, of course, because of lack of time, but I would characterize that as a form of the concentration of power in the hands of corporations under capitalism, in the hands of the state, in state-dominated regimes, in the hands of men in patriarchy and masculinity, in the hands of various different so-called castes and races and ethnicities, and of course in the hands of human beings vis-a-vis other species. And you can think of many other different forms of concentrations of power. I've just named a few, possibly the ones that are the most important. So when we're talking about alternatives, we have to actually ask ourselves, do we have alternatives which fundamentally question and change these structures of domination and exploitation or are we basically remaining at the surface? And we see that's becoming a very important question, because across the world, governments and corporations and many NGOs and many academics are signing on to what seem to be solutions, but which I would characterize as either false or superficial, or, of course, because now that's the new word everybody wants to use, post-truth solutions. They're being thrust down our throats. It could be carbon trading, it could be clean development mechanisms, red plus 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 plus, and even, I would say, sustainable development. And we can go into a discussion later on why I think even that is currently, in the way it's framed, especially with the SDGs of 2015, mostly very superficial. So, do we have systemic alternatives? I think, for me, there are sort of two parts to these systemic alternatives. One part is what's happening across the world, that is resistance. Resistance to this model of development, these kind of dominations that we're seeing, right? And we see this happening in thousands of places across the world, from very small scale, one or two people, to very large scale movements of people resisting against mining and dams and ports and so on, and also, of course, against the structural forces of domination, whether it's patriarchy or racism or whatever. And I think this is very crucial, because not only are these forms of resistance in some ways slowing down the juggernaut of development and giving us a bit more breathing time and space to find alternatives, but also they, in many of them, there is the projection of a different way of looking at things, and a different way of looking at what is human well-being. If it's not development in the way it's defined now, what is it? Is it traditional ways of being? Is it new ways of being? What are the different worldviews that are emerging as part of these resistance movements is really crucial. This is an example from southern India, where this indigenous people fought against a UK-based multinational mining corporation, strangely enough called Vedanta, and successfully so, they stopped it. And when they were doing it, they were, the articulations that were coming were not simply that our livelihoods will be, or our jobs will be destroyed, but that these hills are sacred. And that in any case, who are we to give permission? Because the hills belong to nature and not to us, or to our deity and not to us. It's a very different form of articulation which is coming out in many of these resistance movements. And that's one of the most important parts of them. But even as we resist and protest, we also need to find constructive ways of meeting human needs and aspirations, right? Because there are many parts of the world where people are deprived. And so we find actually in India, we've been doing some documentation of this across the country. And I'll show you a website later on, which has more than 900 stories already of these sorts of alternatives, that across the whole range of human endeavor and sectors, you will find people are actually practicing, conceiving, and trying out alternatives which do not create the sorts of problems that the current model of development is creating. I'm just going to give you a very few examples of this in a minute. Before I do that, I should also mention that similar things are happening across the world. It's not just in India. How many of you do yoga? All right, so if you find this a little disturbing, you can do a headstand. And it will appear right side up again. But I love this map, because it's a very decolonial way of looking at the world. If the world is round, there is no reason why the map we're normally used to is the right side up. This is as much right side up as that one. And as you can see here, Europe is very small, and England disappears. And this actually is the actual physical sizes of the continents, not the normal, so-called normal map that we're used to, which came up during colonial times, just to make Europe look much larger and to be able to show England. So, but anyway, so there are two reasons to put up this map. One was to talk about how our minds are colonized, even by things like maps, but also to be able to just put very quickly on the board a number of other transformative systemic alternatives. Some of you, I'm sure, are familiar with some of these, much more so than I am. But I just wanted to put this out to indicate that it's not just from India that this experience is emerging. Okay, let me give you three or four examples quickly from India, some of them that I'm familiar with. And there's much more documentation available on this on a website that I will show you right at the end. This is an organization of a few thousand Dalit farmers, Dalit women farmers. Those of you who know India will know that Dalits are the most oppressed caste or section of Hindu society in India, 200 million of them. It's not a small number. As women, there's a double oppression because it's a patriarchal, extremely patriarchal society. Many parts of traditional India are extremely patriarchal and masculine. And third, they're small farmers, half an acre, 1 acre, 2 acres of land. So even from a class or caste, gender and class perspective, they're triple disprivileged in Indian society. Over the last 30 years or so, these women have gathered together as collectives and have transformed their agricultural situation to start with from being dependent on chemical green revolution based agriculture, which was not really giving them the sorts of benefits that they wanted, which was making them actually more and more dependent on governments and corporations and so on, back into local biologically diverse organic farming using their own traditional seeds. And along with that, moving to all many different kinds of collective endeavors such as grain banks, such as local public distribution system for poor families who can't afford to buy grains in the market, and so on and so forth. And also then creating their own ability to do outreach by having a media unit, making their own films, running a community radio station that goes to 200 villages, having their own small school, and so on and so forth. So they've actually moved from starting on food sovereignty issues to moving into much larger areas of their lives, saying basically we need to be able to control different aspects of our lives in ways that the government and the corporations will not allow us to control. And the only way to do that is to assert our collective rights and our collective identity and our collective knowledge and wisdom and so on. It's quite an incredible transformation because it's not just with food, but it also is trying to transform in unequal gender and caste relationships, and to some extent successfully doing that. The second example is from Western India, one of the lowest rainfall areas in India, where water has traditionally always been an issue, where in one river basin of about 400 square kilometers, 65 villages got together to try an experiment which ran very well for 10 years, which was to say that let's govern not each village individually and not as conventional political boundaries, but as a river valley. Can we think of the river valley as a political unit and put together what they called a people's parliament, which had representatives from each of these 65 villages, to be able to come together and decide all the matters relating to that river valley, the sharing of water, the planting of or the protection of forests, where the small check dams should be put so that every village gets an equal share of water, and so on and so forth. It has become very weak now for many reasons, but it's a very interesting experiment to look at, and I will talk about it a little later when I talk about a new form of politics. Third example is from Central India. This is an indigenous village where about 35 years back, these people were involved in an anti-dam protest, which they were successful in stopping that dam. But in the process, they also realized that they needed to find ways by which they could actually govern themselves in ways that are much more, where the local nature and natural resources are much more sustainably conserved and used. And also where things like traditionally women not being part of decision-making processes could be transformed. So they reformulated their village assembly, which in India is called the Gram Sabha. And they decided that every decision that is to be taken in this village will be taken only by the entire assembly. Not by a village chief, not by a government officer, not by anybody else, but by the entire village assembly. And even if there is one person dissenting, that decision will not be taken until there is consensus, which could sometimes take a few days. In 2013, this village also completely converted all of its private land into the commons. It's probably one of the first villages in India to actually do that. And they have this slogan where they say that while we elect the government in New Delhi and Mumbai, in our village, we are the government. We are the only ones who will take decisions. I will come back to this in terms of the principles that are emerging a bit later. Just a couple of weeks back, we heard about an indigenous people in Peru that has declared autonomy and self-governance and have started actually stopping mining projects from coming in because they're saying this territory is ours. you can't. The government in Lima cannot decide what happens in our territory. So there's similar things happening in different parts of the world. Finally, we look at urban situations where, because we are way too educated in cities, we don't normally tend to come together as collectives and do these kinds of things, but it's beginning to happen, of course, in many parts of the world. This is an example from Western India, where several colonies in the city have come together to do more self-governance, more autonomous governance, local water self-sufficiency, energy self-sufficiency, housing as far as possible using local materials. And so on. And this is a poor colony, what in India we call slum, which is transformed into this kind of situation here. Well, basically what they're asserting is the same thing as the village before this was asserting, which is that even in a city, as a neighborhood, we are the ones who should be central to decision making, not the city so-called experts who really don't understand what's happening in our own area. So, just very quickly to put up a couple of slides on things happening in other parts of the world. Again, stuff that many of you might be more familiar with than I am. But we see this kind of political transformation, the call for greater local autonomy, more direct democracy, etc., in many parts of the world in different ways. Some places extremely successful, longer term, like I guess parts of the Zapatista or now what the Kurdish Rojava people are trying. Some parts not so successful because, for instance, with Venezuela, the move to local communes was also dependent on government funding. So as the government actually withdraws that funding or its support, some of them kind of begin to collapse. So you have different kinds of and different levels of experience from parts of the world. But the basic urge to self-govern is seen in many of these. Similarly, you look at economic transformations taking place in different parts of the world. If not capitalism, how do you do business? Well, worker-led factories, social and solidarity economy, and so on, it's cooperatives and things like that. I was last couple of years back in Greece at Biome. I don't know if any of you are familiar with that factory, which has been taken over by workers and run completely democratically. They have this big slogan on their factory, says, "We have no boss." Okay, they don't believe in any hierarchies. So there's a whole bunch of these sorts of things happening. Local currencies, where people are asserting that we want to try and move away from the domination of centralized currencies, which are controlled anonymously by somewhere else. Transition movements in Europe, and so on. There's a whole, again, lots and lots of stuff that's happening. We don't have the time to get into it right now. I just wanted to put it up just to make that point. Finally, in terms of the examples, I think it's really crucial also to look at, and yesterday's discussion in the evening that those of you who were there at the round table, and I think some of the discussion possibly in Paige's session also, which I unfortunately missed, was really also about, and political ecology, was really about what's happening in our learning centers. In India at least, the education system has come down from the British time, from the colonial time, is taught to teach kids to conform and be part of the system. There's a bunch of alternatives out there in India and elsewhere which are actually transforming that and saying, no, that's not what a learning environment is. A learning environment is something where kids learn to be questioning human beings, responsible human beings, working again not just with their heads but also with their hearts and their hands. The trio that Gandhi spoke about, the so-called Nayi Taleem system. And so on. And again, there's stuff like this happening in other parts of the world. In Africa, there's a new university called the African Leadership University, whose basic bottom line is decolonizing knowledge. Because as we know, Africa's colonized in more ways than one. And so on. So I think this is very, very interesting. I love actually going back into the origins of words. Anybody here knows the origin of the word school? What does it mean? Original meaning was skole, which meant leisure. I don't know about your countries, but in my country, no schools have leisure. Okay, it's complete opposite of that. But that's being transformed in alternative education and learning systems. Similarly, technology. How does one democratize technology much more so that you're not dependent on so-called experts or corporations, which are the ones who are handing down technology to us, but how do we actually create our own, whether it's with architecture or with energy or with open software or any of the stuff that's happening, the exciting things that are happening in the alternative world in many different ways. Just a quick example, example here. This is a learning center up in Ladakh, very close to Tibet, where it goes to minus 30 degrees. But the way it's built here by the students and the staff is such that with passive solar heating, no artificial heating is required inside, even in winter when it's minus 30 degrees outside. So there's some incredible stuff happening even with technology when you democratize it, when you say each one of us is actually capable of producing knowledge and the technologies relating to that. And the same thing with media. I already gave you the example of the Dalit women farmers who have their own media center. So alternative media of various kinds. Yesterday and in the discussions, of course, there was a lot of talk about so-called social media. Which also has been used in many creative ways, but also traditional media, folk theater, songs, art of various kinds that are coming into or are very effectively used by movements. All right, moving away from examples, and I should say very clearly here that each of these examples has its own issues and problems. None of them are perfect and ideal, but they all show the potential for transformation and for systemic transformation. Is some sort of a more holistic worldview or framework or frameworks emerging from these? That's what I'd like to deal with in the next. How much time do we have? 5 minutes, okay. I think we can look at these transformations from the point of view of five spheres. The political, that's the direct democracy, the social justice, economic democracy, ecological and cultural. This is arbitrary. You can have your own way of dividing up reality. This is what we have come up with through a process that I'll speak about in a couple of minutes. From the perspective of these five spheres, what are the kind of transformations that people are attempting or can and need and should be attempted? So let me deal with each of these in as quick as I can. A new politics. If you go back to that village which said that we are the government in our village, what they're talking about is really that we don't believe in representative democracy or liberal democracy or elections as being the most important part of democracy. What we believe in is that power rests with us. That is the original meaning of democracy, right? Democracy. Power by the people or at the level of people. And you can do that through the kind of assemblies and so on that I mentioned earlier. But you would still need to have decision making at larger levels. So how do you ensure that you would have, for instance, all of Oslo being governed in ways in which the local neighborhood Hello? No. Interesting. It's working? All right. So to have units of governance at larger levels and then all the way, of course, to the... I can't hear an echo, so that's okay. All the way, of course, to the globe. Now, this needs a lot of thinking through. I don't think anybody has all the answers to this. But how do you actually create those forms of delegated and representative democracy where the power still lies at the level of the direct democracy unit and the signals are coming from below rather than power being imposed from above? The third crucial part of the new politics, which is a learning from these examples, especially the example of the River Valley governance unit initiative, is how does one actually start questioning or rethinking political boundaries from the perspective of ecology and culture? Because as we know, a lot of political boundaries across the world, especially the ones that are in the formerly colonized parts of the world, are accidents of history. Somebody sat and drew up a line. I mean, Africa is a classic case where somebody sat in Europe and drew the lines of the different countries. Cutting through ecological contiguities, cutting through cultural linkages and so on. So how do you actually start reimagining political boundaries, including nation-state boundaries, from the perspective of a radical ecology or ecological politics is something that is really emerging also from some of these examples. Thank you. For all this to happen, of course, there are four conditions that I think are very important. First, each of us needs to have the right to participate. As far as I know, there's no country in the world which gives us a fundamental right to participate in all decisions affecting our lives. Partially in some cases, yes, but not all. Secondly, the capacity. We have been so incapacitated by thinking that governments will do things for us and that our only right is to vote once in 3 years or 4 years or 5 years, that we need to rebuild that capacity to be able to participate meaningfully in decision-making bodies. Third, forums, whether it's village assemblies or neighborhood assemblies or town councils or whatever, as forums in which we have access to and which we can participate. And finally, and possibly the most important, wisdom or maturity, which ensures that I'm sensitive to your needs. Just because you are a minority and I'm a majority doesn't mean I impose my view on you, right? So that wisdom and maturity, which also you see in some of these examples, is another very important condition. Then we get into a new economics, from many of these examples and others, which is really about localization instead of economic globalization, but an open localization, because I'm not talking the right-wing politics of today, which is also saying localization. I'm saying localization where for basic needs, we can actually try and generate everything that we need within a certain local region. But we're also not saying, okay, no refugees or nobody from outside can come here. So, I mean, it's a complicated kind of thing, but that's one of the parts of the new economics, where production and consumption are controlled by producers and consumers, and we all, in one way or the other, become prosumers, because we all can be producers, and we, of course, are also consumers, contributing to each other. Where livelihoods, not jobs, livelihoods is brought back into our lives where we actually enjoy doing the work that we want to do. So you don't have this sharp division between work and leisure. Where there's a recommoning of private property, obviously one of the most difficult things to happen, in, especially in places like this. And where money becomes a far less important part of our life. Where you actually rebuild relationships of caring and sharing. I think today there's a whole bunch of workshops on affection and caring and showing and so on. So I'm sure these things will be discussed over there. The third crucial ingredient of this dish is justice. I don't need to elaborate this, but basically, again, talk. If you go back to the Dalit women farmers and their struggle for justice was not just food sovereignty, but also as women, also as Dalits, and also as depressed classes. Fourth, very important part, culture and knowledge. India, for instance, has 800 living languages, not dialects, full languages. This encodes incredible libraries of knowledge. As we impose cultural homogeneity in the name of education and modernization, we're losing this knowledge. How do you actually celebrate and retain the diversity of cultures, including languages, food systems, and so on? Would it not be so boring if all of us only had hamburgers to eat? Right, so, which unfortunately is what the corporate world would like us to do. Knowledges, we already spoke about that yesterday, decolonizing the mind, that map, go back to that so-called upside down map. Democratizing science, technology, knowledge, understanding that each one of us is a potential generator of knowledge, a transmitter of knowledge, a storer of knowledge. Bringing media back into the commons rather than be controlled by corporations and so on. And then, of course, us as individuals, and how do we try and go back deeper into ourselves? What are the opportunities available for us for spiritual growth? 2 minutes more? Thank you. The fifth ingredient, renewing our relationship within nature, rethinking that we are part of nature and it's not something outside of us. And just to give you a quick example of this, hundreds of places in the world where indigenous peoples and local communities are asserting their territorial governance and custodianship over the nature that they live within and saying that's the form of conservation, not your westernized, exclusionary, protected area model. So the dish that's emerging out of this is what in India we're calling Eco-swaraj or radical ecological democracy. It's very simple, deceptively simple. Which is, also going back to words, radical does not mean extremist. So when in India we say radicalized youth for so-called, you know, extreme Hindu or Islamic elements, That's the wrong use of the word. Radical simply means going to the roots. It's a good word. So it's very simple. Wherever we are, in whatever collectives we're talking about, we are part of decision-making processes. We're not leaving it to somebody else. But as we're doing that, we're sensitive to ecological considerations and to social considerations of each other. And so therefore, what we're doing is we're placing the community, the collective, defined in many different ways, at the center of things, not the government nor the corporation. Quickly, the word Swaraj, which I'm using in Eco-swaraj, is really this. My autonomy and freedom, but in responsibility to your autonomy and freedom. And when we say your, it's also other species, not just human beings. Similar worldviews are again being asserted, reasserted, coming up in different parts of the world. Some of you will be familiar with these. I'm running out of time now, so I'm going a bit quickly. This is my most important slide, I think, which is that I think what unites a lot of us, or could unite a lot of us, in celebration of the diversity of ecologies and ideologies and politics and economics and so on that we all come from, or these examples come from, is a fundamental set of values, ethics. I think that's what could be the core of an ecological politics or a political ecology or of any of the work that we're doing. So I'm just going to put up a whole bunch of these which have emerged from the experience in India. We obviously need another whole 3-day conference to get into this. So I'm not going to go there. But just to put them up for a minute so that you can look at this, and then maybe in the discussion or in the next few days, we can, if we meet in the corridors, we can talk about some of this. To end, I would like to say that one of the biggest issues is, there's a whole bunch of questions that we need to get into which are crucial. Who is going to catalyze this change? Who is already doing it? Is there a role for the state? Are we talking about stateless societies? Are we talking about anarchy? What is it that we're talking about? Or maybe different systems? Is there a role for a business sector? What would that be? Social cooperatives, community run, et cetera, et cetera. How do we rethink our own academics and epistemological work and so on? How do we reach critical mass? Quickly, a process we're working on in India. This is called the Alternatives Confluence, where we try and get people who are working on these different things together on common platforms to share, to build further collaborations, to build a wider critical mass. It's a sharing of worldviews and experiences and practices and so on. But it's also the attempt to actually try and build a more collective vision of what we want the future of India or the future of the world to look like from bottom up, where we can take from the best of Marx and Gandhi and so on and so forth, but we're also building on the ideas and the wisdom of people, so-called ordinary people at the grassroots. Emerging from this is a book that has just been recently released, which Hanne talked about, which is Dreaming the Future. One of the biggest problems with modernity is that we're not allowed to daydream anymore. We have to be constantly working all the time or staring at our screens. Can we sit back and say, okay, here's my dream for 2100 for the world? And then come back and say, okay, how do I get there? So this volume, which we will introduce tomorrow morning, is a part of that. We also have worked on something called it's a tool for looking at alternatives transformation. If you're working, for instance, on gender transformation, are you also sensitive to ecological, social, cultural, other sorts of things? That kind of thing can be looked at. I'd be happy to send this tool around to the network. And then we're coming up with a global one. Some of us are editing a volume which has 110 essays of things happening around the world, practical and conceptual. Please look out for this. It should be out later this year, and we'll discuss it tomorrow morning. And final proposal, that like the Indian confluence, do we have the appetite? Is there a need? Is it possible to do a global alternatives confluence? People working on all these different wonderful things happening around the world, challenging each other in looking at what sorts of issues are coming up. And there is, in fact, going to be a preliminary discussion on this in the upcoming degrowth meetings in Malmo and in Mexico City. You're most welcome to these sessions if you're going to be there. And my last slide. People often say, yeah, nice, great vision, but it's too utopian. You know, forget it, we can't get there. And so I love this quote, which is Eduardo Galeano quoting from an Argentinian director. Utopia is on the horizon. I move two steps closer, it moves two steps further away. I walk another 10 steps and utopia runs 10 steps further away. As much as I may walk, I never reach it. So what's the point? The point is this, it makes us continuously advance. If we did not have these visions, we would not even be trying to get beyond where we are right now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ashish, for an excellent contribution to this conference and also to a debate and thinking that is really important. Okay, so now I want to invite Paul Robbins up as a discussant. Paul is the director of the Nelson Institute for Environmental Studies at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And Paul will be a keynote speaker later today. Welcome, Paul.
And let me back up, because this slide's great, but I think we could spend a month on that one. Boy, that's a lot. So I'll let people read that and not listen to me. I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me the rare opportunity to share the podium with Ashish Kothari, who has very long been an inspiration for me. It's a huge honor on my bucket list that leaves like Donna Haraway and David Harvey and Paige West and Sir Michael Caine, pretty much. I mean, that's where this is for me. So let me start by saying I had the text of this and how much Kothari's vision like stuck with me. Because once many years ago, somebody asked me, and I don't remember when, if I had a month to live, what would I do with it? What would I do with the last 30 days of my life? And the answer was, travel around the planet, that's what I said, and find stuff that works, right? That provides some kind of orthogonal or that runs athwart of the crushing devastation that we see more typically. And what I realized is, that's what this guy does for a living, and why would I wait until I'm on my deathbed? So it's a really inspirational manifesto, and it's not an aspirational one because it's filled with examples. You can feel